Penguin Random House Audio presents Center, Center, a funny, sexy, sad, almost memoir of a boy in ballet. This is the author, James Whiteside. For my mother, Nancy. Dear listener, there is a mark on every stage around the world that signifies the center of its depth and width, called Center, Center. Since I was 12 years old, I have dreamed of standing on that very mark as a principal dancer with the illustrious American Ballet Theatre at the Metropolitan Opera House at New York City's Lincoln Center. This absurd, non-chronological collection of essays tells the story of how I got there, from the inevitable coming-out story to the evolution of my career to fantastical run-ins with Jesus Christ on Grindr. I always knew I wanted to write a book. In true delusional form, I had given it the title Center, Center when I was around 20 years old, a good 15 years before writing the damned thing. Talk about putting the cart before the horse. When an editor at Penguin contacted me in 2019 and asked coolly, "Have you ever considered writing a book?" I nearly fainted. A New Yorker is always busy, so my first task was to set aside a chunk of time to write. I asked my boss, American Ballet Theatre Artistic Director Kevin McKenzie, if I could skip the Nutcracker during the 2019 season, and he obliged. My friends Nate and Peter offered their uninhabited upstate cottage to me. I packed my coziest sweatpants and took the Amtrak up to Rhinecliff, where I sat in an unfinished kitchen in the dead of winter, without heat, while it snowed foot upon foot. Gazing out onto the frozen pond, I wrote tales of denial, ambiguous relationships with male friends, wronged girlfriends, major setbacks and triumphs in ballet, and death in the family. The memories in this book all meet at a crossroads with self-awareness, acceptance, irony, friendship, love, and sex. The honesty with which I present myself has come at a high price, paid in life experiences. Each essay in this collection will shock. Some are rather NC-17. Amuse, embolden, and inspire. At 37, I have realized my childhood dream. What, if anything, is left? Let's find out together, standing under the dusty spotlight on Center, Center. Mared, as they say. James Whiteside. Getting your dream job is as easy as ABT. I was 12 when my first dance teachers, Angie and Steve, took me to New York City's famed Lincoln Center to see an American Ballet Theatre performance. It was early spring in 1996. The Twin Towers still stood, the premiere of Sex and the City was on the horizon, and the outrageous gentrification of New York City's grimiest neighborhoods had yet to occur. It was a magical time for the world's most vivaciously vicious city. ABT's Spring Gala is structured like a greatest hits show. It's chock full of excerpted scenes from the company's most famous ballets, Swan Lake, Don Quixote, and Romeo and Juliet, as well as American classics by Twyla Tharp, Agnes DeMille, Anthony Tudor, and Mark Morris. The Spring Gala is the easiest way to understand why ABT is the most prestigious classical ballet company in the United States and why Congress declared it America's National Ballet Company. I was struggling with ballet at the time and much preferred my tap and jazz classes. At that age, dancing to Janet Jackson is preferable to dancing to canned piano ballet class music via cassette tape. But my teachers knew I had potential in ballet, so they took me to the show in an attempt to inspire me. In those pre-YouTube days, I had no access to videos of great ballet dancers, nor could I follow my favorite dancers on Instagram. There was no Googling of Rudolf Nureyev or Mikhail Baryshnikov. I was a ballet ignoramus. It was the first time I saw what ballet could be. I watched that ABT gala performance the way a Pop Warner football player watches the Super Bowl. As a child with a flair for the absurdly theatrical, I was struck by the show's obvious glamour. I also witnessed men in tights for the first time. I recall thinking, "What on earth is going on in there?" Like many of my earliest homosexual inclinations, I mistook my attraction for simple curiosity. I was blown away by the performance, the virtuosity, the music, the costumes, the drama, the butts. Angie and Steve had an old friend named Kirk Peterson, who was an ABT ballet master, a coach, and they took me backstage to say hello. A towering security guard with a clipboard of names led us through to the dressing rooms, where the floor transformed from utilitarian tile to luxurious red carpeting, and the lighting eased into a soft, incandescent ambiance. Next to some red velvet sofas was a small table with dozens of filled champagne flutes, ripe for the picking. Dressers, theater staff who assist with getting artists in and out of very intricate costumes, milled about, hanging costumes to dry and gathering dirty bags of laundry. Ballerinas ghosted around in long silk kimonos and house slippers, talking to each other while taking down their beautifully braided updos. Male dancers laughed and homoerotically jostled each other, wearing nothing but their tights and suspenders. Some were even drinking sweaty beers. I think it is still the sexiest place I have ever been. "Where are we?" I asked, with the awe of someone witnessing the rapture. "The principal hallway, darling," Angie replied in her British accent. We had successfully infiltrated the sacred dressing grounds of ABT's star dancers. I thought to myself, this will be my home one day. When you're a young ballet student, where do you summer does not mean where are your myriad vacation homes. Many dance schools in cities and towns the world over house summer programs. Angie and Steve suggested I audition for ABT's summer intensive in the year 2000 when I was 15. What a time to be a teenager! I auditioned and received a full scholarship to the program. I believe my teachers pulled some strings with their friends at ABT to ensure I could go. My family had zero extra income for summer dance camps, which can cost thousands of dollars. I commuted every day from Fairfield, Connecticut to Union Square in New York City, where ABT's studios are located, because my mother would not let me live alone in the city for the summer. It was a long commute, but it was perhaps my favorite part of the day. I'd board the Metro North train with my dance bag, my Discman, a sleeve of CDs, and a notebook. It was never overcrowded in those times, and I always found a seat. There are too many goddamn people in the world now. I'd settle into the maroon and beige vinyl seats, pop in a Fiona Apple or Ani DiFranco album, and write poetry or journal for an hour and a half, fueled by teenage angst and hormones. Most of my journal entries began with homosexual curiosity and ended in guilt-ridden heterosexual cover-ups. I wrote as though I was sure my journal was going to be discovered and published someday. I've always been a champ at delusion. I was placed in the third lowest level, blue, out of 10 levels at the ABT Summer Intensive. I quickly became very aware that I was not as refined a dancer as many of the star students. Ballet's young prodigies all went to ABT's summer program in hopes of getting into ABT's studio company, ABT's apprentice company. There was a performance at the end of the program in which excerpts of various classical ballets were performed for a paying audience. It served as a capitalist scheme. Rich parents, bwahaha! As well as an audition for the studio company. I didn't have a hope in hell. My first year, I danced a crunchy modern piece in culottes. There was no way they'd let me near classical ballet. I was not offered a place in the studio company. No surprise there. That first year, I was not yet out of the closet, even though I had been hooking up with my two best friends in Connecticut, Kurt and Jordan, for years. However, I was aware of my attraction to guys. There was a short 15-year-old Latino boy named Julian at ABT who fascinated me. He was a native New Yorker, cussed up a storm, and had a very developed body. I was drawn to his muscled physique and gruff demeanor. Julian defined himself as bisexual. We had a sleepover at his New York apartment, and he talked to me about his girlfriend. "We can't hook up because I'm in a relationship," he whispered, inches from my face, "but we can cuddle." So we cuddled through the night, and our boners threatened to spontaneously combust. Throughout the ABT Summer Intensive, I was awed and inspired not only by the dancers of the main company, but also by my fellow students. They were well-trained, disciplined, lithe creatures who barreled through the technically difficult combinations. Each ballet class was a fresh competition in which students tried to prove why they should be a part of the main company. Every glimpse of the elusive artists of American Ballet Theatre incentivized young dancers to reach for the stars and work just that much harder. Paloma Herrera, an Argentine prima ballerina, stalked the hallways icily, always diligently setting to her task of being the consummate professional and artist. Stunned students stood speechless, pressed against the wall.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.